registrazione c'è.
Tu puoi fare questo, tu puoi usare quello, sì, adesso ti presento e poi puoi fare lo screen sharing.
Già fatto. Teoria, perché tu lo stai vedendo, quindi si vede già.
Direi che c'è tutto. Tu sei muto, giusto?
Io non ho messo l'audio
Perfetto. Allora, anche il tuo boom è muto.
fino a perché non sono collegato all'audio. Cioè, lo boom non ha l'audio adesso.
So it's time to restart. Last lecture of the day about the school, again on devices that allow us to perform all the various ideas that to let the ideas become reality. So now we go to the photo detection world. The lecturer is Alberto Gola from FBK. He will show you better what FBK is, Foundation in Trento. And so as for the other speaker, you have 1 minute to introduce yourself without notice, and then we can start with the lectures.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me here. It's a very nice place and very nice school. So I am Alberto Gola and I am chief scientist at Fondazione Bruno Kessler, responsible for the development of the single photon sensor. And this type of sensor is relevant for many applications that might be also of interest for the science community. So maybe a quick introduction on FBK. Maybe some people know already, some people don't know. We are located in the northeast of Italy, between Verona and essentially Innsbruck. And we are a private foundation with public functions. So basically, we are an RTO, a research and technology organization. We're around 500 researchers in different fields, and we get 50% of funding from local government. And the rest is 25% from publicly funded, cioè IFM, for example, or European projects. And also we do collaborations with companies. No? And in particular, FBK has many research centers inside. So I'm from the Sensor and Devices Center, which accounts for around 150 people. And we operate our own clean room. As a matter of fact, it's a system of clean room, so it's free clean room for in the future. They are detector grade, so world class to make detectors. So we don't make CMOS circuits. We don't have the lithography necessary for that, but we are state of the art for detectors. And as a matter of fact, silicon photomultiplier is one type of detector. This is the topic of today's talk, and accounts for a significant portion of the detectors fabricated in FBK. We also do LGAD, low gain avalanche diode, which are quite famous at the moment in the high energy physics community. We do silicon drift detectors and so on. And so we are a research center, so we are typically interested in R&D activities and collaboration. So we act really as a public entity. Whereas if you need to handle large area productions or commercial productions, then we collaborate with external entities, such as an external foundry, which for example is a foundry in Avezzano, or we also do commercialization to Broadcom, which is a big company. And so some of our devices now are on DGK, no? You can buy on the web with the Broadcom logo. And so I wanted to, so today's presentation is divided into parts, which fits very well the structure suggested, no? So of course you can interrupt me whenever you want, but essentially this presentation here, I will go back to that one later on, because it talks about a little bit the ongoing development, no? So the latest research that we are doing in FPK. But there is another introduction presentation to CTM, just to explain to people who maybe never used it or never had an insight of how it works. But I wanted to start from this presentation because to hopefully raise your interest, because I understand, of course, you are from the science community. And so, because I wanted to mention the application of a silicon photomultiplier. So, everything starting from positron emission tomography, which is a medical imaging application. So you want to read out the 511 kilo electron volt photon generating from an annihilation inside the patient body. So this is the ring of a PET imager. And then if you have, you read out them through a scintillator, so that converts the gamma energy into visible photons. And then you need to detect the visible photon with a silicon photomultiplier. And if you detect that with a good enough time resolution, you can restrict the distribution probability along the line of response because they are anti-parallel, the emission more or less anti-parallel. But then by the time of flight, you can improve the image quality. So this is where everything started from, no? Medical imaging, which is also a typical spin-off of CERN, for example. But recently, thanks to the very fast improvement of performance of SIPMs, there is a really a growing interest in almost every big physical experiment to use them, for example, typically as a replacement for the traditional photomultiplier tube. Okay. And so we have examples here that we are working on, cryogenic TPCs. This is probably the most relevant for you. This is dark side, obviously, but also astrophysics. This is CTA. And then we also have high energy physics experiment. And this was an example from the R&D we did for the barrel timing layer of the CMS, this at the bottom. And the common feature here is that actually there is no common feature. Now you need to do a lot of customization, especially for science. There is no such a thing as a one size fits all. So what we do is as a research center, so maybe a company would not do that because the companies want to make a lot of the same. We are a research center, so we do customization. So cryogenic operation, large area view sensitivity, or reduction of crosstalk, maximization of the PD for CTA, and also radiation hardness, which is a very hot topic, maybe less relevant for the cryogenic application. And I will try to discuss a little bit of this optimization in the second part of the talk. And this customization reflects in quite a complicated technology roadmap. Now we started simpler in 2010, and then we are making a lot of maybe incremental development. Now it's not always a revolution in our technology because you don't want to do a revolution for reliability, for TRL technology readiness level, but you still have to do a lot of customization. This is why it's interesting, at least for us, working on the detector. So let me switch the presentation to the introduction, actually, because to understand what we are talking about, it's probably good to discuss what is a silicon photomultiplier. So maybe we can define a silicon photomultiplier in many ways, but maybe we can define it through this, its characteristics, its performance. So it's a single photon detector with internal signal amplification that is fabricated on a CMOS compatible silicon wafer, which doesn't mean a CMOS wafer like to make transistors essentially, but it's a CMOS compatible. The machines are the same. And the capability is that you can detect single photon in the visible or near infrared range with a simple, which means low power typically, which is important also in cryogenic readout electronics. And you can get excellent timing performance down to 50 or actually most recently 20 picosecond full width at maximum of single photon time resolution, SPTR. And also you can count photons, a few photons or many photons depending on the design. And this is just a spectrum of the photon counting capability. And on the right, you see an example of the SPTR as a function of the bias of the device. Just an example. And then how is it made? This is a solid state detector as opposed to photomultiplier tube with silicon. And then it exploits the multiplication of carriers, electron holes, through the impact ionization. And the advantages compared to the older technology, which is the PNT, is low bias, compact, rugged, and insensitive to magnetic fields. This is the typical reverse IV, so bias versus current. Of a junction, of the PIN junction, and you can identify three regions. No? So you start from a low bias in reverse, and then you have the linear region here. Then if you increase further the bias, you get some multiplication of the carrier, so you get one couple generated by one photon, but then you read out more because impact ionization multiplies the charge through the electric field. And then typically in the textbook, they say you can get an operation beyond the breakdown voltage. Breakdown is breaking the device.
However, this is only partially true because there are ways to make the device operative even beyond the breakdown voltage. This is just an example. Right? It's not always 27 volt, just at some high bias in reverse. And then you operate in the so-called Geiger mode. So counting, no? Have a photon, you generate one avalanche, and that's stop, and then you're ready for a new avalanche. But how is it possible? Well, it's correct, no? In a normal condition, if you are biased above a breakdown, you have an infinite, obviously there is not a real infinite, but a very high current, so not a detector. However, the condition, so this is on the, where is it? Okay. On the right, this is again a conceptual drawing of the current versus voltage. So you have, in this case, the axis is reversed. So you have the breakdown and you operate at a certain bias beyond the breakdown. However, this is not true that it's immediately diverging current. Actually, it's a metastable condition. This is a cross-section of a typical device. So it's a P epitaxial, and then, okay, N, it's not relevant. So this is the depletion region. And when you operate above breakdown, so you apply a certain bias between the N and the P, forget about this for the moment, you are depleting, no? You have a volume which is depleted of silicon, and then it's there that you can detect photons, or you can detect generation of chirals by thermal generation inside the silicon. But as a matter of fact, when you are at above breakdown, for example, VA, this is a metastable condition. So as long as no carrier is present there, like it's not thermally generating, it's not generated by a photon, there is no current. So the current is zero, even above breakdown. Then, of course, you can generate a couple of carriers here. You trigger the avalanche. So for the moment, you just believe me, no? I will explain later on how it works. And so the current abruptly increases a lot. But you have a limiting to this current, no? So typically, you place something that limits the current, so it doesn't go to infinite. Actually, in every real system, there is a resistor, there is something that limits the current. And so you have detected the photons, but then you would be above breakdown in avalanche, no? So you need some mechanism to reset the system so you are ready to detect another photons. And so this is called quenching. So you essentially need to reduce the bias below or at breakdown, which is the minimum bias that can sustain the avalanche by definition. And typically this is a resistor. You just place a resistor in series. And then as soon as it reaches the breakdown, then the avalanche is quenched and the microcell, the diode, is recharged to the operating region. And so you close the loop and you're ready to detect another photon. So this is the SPAD, single photon avalanche diode. There are drawbacks or limitations at least to the SPAD because it's a single cell. So essentially it's a digital device. So in this case, you generate one photon inside the silicon, you absorb and generate the couple, you have an avalanche. You have a pulse with 10 photons, you still have an avalanche, no? Because the only thing that can happen is getting an avalanche. So it has uses, of course, but it has limitation. It has cannot count. And also there are limits to the maximum size. No? The typical size of this side here is 20 to 100 micrometer. So what you could do to get back some information on the amplitude of the light intensity, if you want, is that you can, it's very simple. You put many of them in parallel with their quenching resistor. No? SPAD quenching resistor in parallel with all of the others. And this is a typical, just a picture of what could be a silicon. And the microcell is typically smaller. And thanks to this, essentially, you get back your amplitude sensitivity because all the currents, because they are in parallel, they are summed at the readout band. So this is a typical waveform at the oscilloscope in which you count. No? This is a pulse shape, but then if you've got two photons, you have this, some people used to call it a little hand diagram, no? Because you in the histogram you have fingers. And essentially, you get partially amplitude information. Of course, this is not a perfectly linear detector. The maximum number of photons that you can count is at most the number of microcells. And of course, I'm talking about pulse measurement. No? Then, of course, the cell recharges, and then you can still count more. No? But in a pulse, you have a limited number of cells available. But the number is large, and so you can get a spectrum, for example, no? A gamma spectrum, and so on.
And okay, this is just an example how it looks like. Maybe you have seen it, maybe not. This is test package done in-house by our technician. You get something more professional, industrial, you can also do that. Different packages. This is a SIP on a test package with a scintillator on top, and this is an array. No? Then if you need to read out even larger areas, you can combine many of these SIP that are, for example, with an area between 1 by 1 and 10 by 10 square millimeter, you can combine in an array. And there are many applications. I already went through them. So this is the rest of the world. No? It's not only science. You get medical imaging, high energy physics, as I said, biotech, fluorescence lifetime analysis, for example, safety. This is a portal to reveal hidden radioactive sources or contaminated, maybe not in iron. Analytical instrumentation and recently LiDAR. No? Everyone is getting crazy these days because they think LiDAR is going to be automotive LiDAR, obviously. It's going to be a big thing, and silicon photomultiplier are one of the most promising candidates. So we're working more or less on all these applications. How you do you build this microcell, no? Which is the base building block of a silicon photomultiplier? And this is a typical cross-section, no? So a cut in the wafer. There are many cells in parallel, but I just described one. So the device is built on an epitaxial silicon, which means we have a bulk, very highly doped, silicon never depleted, so in first, at first order, not sensitive to photons. Then you have the epitaxial layer, which is low doping, high resistivity. You get a depletion when you apply reverse bias, few micrometers thick, no? Close to the interface here, because of diffusion from the bulk during the fabrication of the epitaxial layer, you have some transition region. No? You get from undepleted to depleted. And then what you have a shallow implant, a superficial implant, which is of the opposite type as the bulk and the epitaxial. It should be very thin because also this one is not depleted. Now you cannot deplete it until the surface, but it should be thin because if you have photons, photons come from top. This is oxide, so it's transparent. And they generate, and they are 400 nanometer, they generated in maybe 100 nanometer thickness. So you want them to be collected. So you want that the neutral region, which is not very good for charge collection, to be very thin. So this is a critical technology parameter. And then you have the high field region, which is achieved through a deep implant, deep ion implant of the same polarity as the epitaxial. So basically you have the P and then side, no? But you have an enrichment implant, so you increase the electric field in this region, which is how you get the avalanche multiplication. Now you need to accelerate the electrons or the holes to a certain energy so that they can ionize other carriers, other atoms. And finally, you need to get an isolation between adjacent cells, no? Because otherwise it would be a single device altogether, no? Instead, you want different microcells all in parallel, so they should be isolated electrically. So this is a deep trench. It's a trench digged through the silicon, etched through the silicon, and that serves as an electrical isolation. So you have a common contact on the back, but separated contacts on the top, and also optical simulation. We will see the isolation. We will see why later. And the virtual guarding is another feature that you need. You need to leave some space besides the high field region to avoid that the avalanche also happens towards laterally in some sense, because this is a high defectivity region. So you don't want to multiply carriers generated here because there's a lot of noise. You want to multiply only below, so not lateral. So you need to have a safety margin essentially. And if you plot the dopant concentration along a vertical cross section in the center of the device, you see something like this. Now you have the whole concentration, the electron concentration, and in orange you have the absolute net doping, which is essentially the difference between the two. And so you have the junction here. Now this goes to zero. This is logarithmic plot. This is conceptual. Now it's not the real, but it's close to real. No, it's around 1 micrometer of the deep implant, and then you have the shallow implant, and then the bulk. Now the bulk goes very, very high. And assuming you have depletion, essentially this is the depleted region here, no? Because this is the concentration of free carriers. This is the fixed charge after ionization. When you deplete the mobile carriers, you get the atoms, the dopant atoms.
And the electric field is essentially the integral of the charge. No? So you go up here because you have a certain polarity of charge, you have a field, and then you reach the other implant, and go down, and then you don't go to zero because otherwise this would not be depleted. And so you can collect from here and multiply here because here you have a very high field where you have impact ionization. And this is what I said. Now, but behind that, you have a drift region, and then you have undepleted region, which are not very good for charge collection. So they should be thin, at least in the surface. And then the bike. And this is not the only way you can do a SIPM. You can do it without the deep trench. If you remember, I said we need electrical isolation. So you can skip the DTI, deep trench isolation. You put an end stop here, or P stop if it's the opposite polarity. Or you can do also the deep junction. All of this stuff we have done or we are doing now. This is a very, very recent development, which I didn't put in the presentation. Okay, just give me a second because it's very, very hot. Okay, so maybe what is interesting for you is that as a user, now maybe some of you will eventually work in detector development, but most of you probably are interested in using these devices. No, so you need to have a certain understanding of how they work to use them properly, but you also want to have the perspective of the user. No, so. For example, what is the signal that is generated by this device? So the signal, so again, I have this microsection. This is the equivalent circuit, no? Physically in some sense. So I have a SPAD and a quenching resistor in series, no? As I said. But you also have the small signal equivalent circuit, which is useful if you want to simulate in SPICE the signal, the electrical signal that you get from the device. And then in this case, the SPAD, the junction, is replaced by a switch, which is open normally, no? When you are in the metastable condition, no charge, no current is flowing. You have a resistor in series because there is always some non-ideality, so there is a resistor. The capacitance, which is the junction capacitance. And then the quenching resistor comes together with a parasitic capacitor physically related to the size of the quenching resistor. No? And then you have a grid capacitance that is the capacitance to ground or to the backside of the metal grid that connects your device. So what happens when you get a photon? You trigger an avalanche with a certain probability, and we'll see that thing as well. And then we can model this as a switch that closes. Now the avalanche current goes up, so it's like you close a switch. And by the way, before triggering the avalanche, you apply your bias, which is the breakdown voltage plus the excess bias, which we call over voltage. So on the small signal, you just consider the over voltage, no? Because the breakdown is an offset. It can always, it's always there, no? Even before the avalanche and after the avalanche is triggered. And so your capacitance, so no current flows, so this is zero. The bias here is zero because it's shorted by the quenching, whereas this is charged to the excess bias or over voltage. Then you switch the avalanche, you close the switch, and then a current starts flowing in the switch. Now, so you discharge the diode capacitance, but you get no signal from this, no? Because it's local, it's a loop, it's a current loop. But at the same time, you are charging this quenching capacitor, which is between the cathode and the readout pen. And this current goes up, comes from outside, and you get a peak, a fast peak, no? Because this is the fast transient in the order of 100 picosecond. And then you reach the breakdown voltage, so the avalanche can no longer be sustained, and then it's quenched, so the switch is open again. And what happened now then? You recharge the diode capacitance through the quenching resistor with a certain time constant. So you have an exponential recharge, you have a fast peak and an exponential recharge. And then you discharge the quenching capacitor, but you don't care, no? Because it's local. So the output current has this shape, and it has two components, a fast component and an exponential component.
So how does the avalanche grow? So this is a statistical process. Now, first of all, it's not always triggered. And this is an old simulation by the Politecnico Group, Politecnico Milano, in which you can do Monte Carlo, ab initio, maybe simulations of the current evolution over time after a hole is generated in the device and goes through the high field region. And you can see that in some cases the current is increasing because impact ionization, so it's not just a single charge, it gets more, but not diverging. And in some other cases, you have some divergence of the current. No? And this is probably better represented. There is a very nice simulation. Let's see if you can, maybe from here. Where is the pointer? Oops. Okay, this is a spud, a circular spud. You get absorption in one corner, and then this is the current density that expands. Now, this is 200 microns, I think. And then you see that these mesos here, because you can expand, increase the current of the avalanche either by diffusion, so the charge multiplicated diffuses, but also by crosstalk, and we will see later, no? Inter-cell crosstalk. So the avalanche emits photons by itself. No? And these photons can be triggered within the same microcell. So the current grows, essentially. No? And this is what you want, because you don't want the current of a single electron or a single hole. You want a current which is a million times higher, which is much, much easier to detect. And then how do you quench the avalanche? So the passive quenching, which is the mechanism that we use, is, as I said, achieved when the bias across the junction reaches the breakdown, which is the minimum value that can bear the avalanche, no? Sustain the avalanche. As a matter of fact, in this case, you have a current limitation, no? Because you have the excess bias to the bias path. You have the breakdown to the spud, and you have a resistor, so it's very easy, no? You get the current by division, no? So this is the current before the breakdown. And if you zoom in, this is again on a quality level, but essentially this is a value, a certain value, which is low enough, so that because this is not a deterministic current, no, not at this level. So basically you have fluctuation, but at some time, if the current is low enough, the fluctuation passes to zero. But if you have a current that goes to zero, it means you have no longer any carrier inside the device, inside the depleted region, which means you cannot further multiply. So the avalanche is quenched. There is no longer an avalanche. And it happens in the picosecond range. There is an empirical limit for the quenching. No? So it shouldn't exceed the 20 microampere at the spud level, which means at least 50 kOhm per voltage of excess bias are necessary to achieve a good quench, no? Because you want to limit the current to a low level so that it can go to zero. What happens if you don't do your homework properly? So this is a typical pulse, very fast with exponential, but you have a bad quenching, like you don't have a resistor high enough, or maybe you apply too much bias for the resistor that you are using, you have an avalanche that takes a lot of time to quench, or maybe it doesn't quench at all. No? So I don't know if this is faster, is it fine, or do you want to ask a question? Is reasonable? Okay. And then another very relevant parameter of the simple photo multiplier is its gain. No? The gain is the measure of the number of carriers that pass through the high field region of one microcell during an avalanche. This is our purpose, essentially. No? Otherwise, it would be a diode. And it's easy to measure. As a matter of fact, it's the integral of the output current. No? The charge should come from outside. That's gain. And as I said, you have these two features, and the fast coupling is good for timing performance, no? Because the faster the slope, the easier the timing. And again, is if you do the charge balance in the simple model I showed you before, essentially it's quite easy. You shouldn't do the integral, essentially it's excess bias, the bias in excess of the breakdown or the overvoltage, sometimes it's called, times the sum of the capacitors per cell. And the recharge time constant is the quenching resistor times this same capacitance. And these are typical values, no? A few millions, 10 to the 7 maybe, it depends on the size of the microcell, because the capacitance is obviously parallel plate. When you are in the depletion, can be assumed to be parallel plate, so the bigger the microcell, the larger the gain of the capacitance and the larger the gain. Whereas the punching resistor are this value around 1 megaohm, and then the tau of the recharge is between 8 nanosecond and 100 nanosecond recharge constant. Then, of course, probably one of the most important parameters when you're talking about a photodetector is the photon detection efficiency, no? That's what you care most. And the photodetection efficiency is the product of three terms, no? The filling factor, the quantum efficiency, and the avalanche triggering probability. So if we start from the quantum efficiency, this is an example of the quantum efficiency measured on a diode with the same structure as the silicon photomultiplier. So you have anti-reflective coating here that limit the quantum efficiency at some wavelength below 300 nanometer. And this is the diode, no? And the diode is, well, actually it's a good value to start with, but then you are limited because the thickness of the epitaxial layer, as I said, is 3/4 micron or 5, and it's limited, no? So at some point, the silicon starts to be transparent to the infrared light. For example, 9 nanometer, the absorption length is around 30 micrometer, I think, or well, in the order of tens of micrometer. So if I have 5, it gets to. But then, after getting the photon in and absorbing it, I need to start the avalanche, no? And to this purpose, we can analyze two situations, no? A blue photon that is absorbed very close to the surface, that's why we need a shallow implant at the surface, or a red photon that can be absorbed all along the thickness. For convenience, I put it here. And so this is a couple that's generated. In this case, it's a p-n-n junction, so the drift for the electron, they go down, whereas the hole go up. And essentially they transverse the high field region into the opposite direction. So in this, for blue photon absorption, you get electrons that multiply, the start of the avalanche, no? Enter the high field region and trigger the avalanche. Whereas if you absorb light below the high field region, it's hole. And because essentially of mobility difference, no? The hole in silicon have less mobility, that they go less slower at the same value of the field. Essentially, there is a difference in the probability of triggering an avalanche in the ionization coefficient. So essentially, you can in blue you have the avalanche triggering probability for electrons as a function of the depth. Of course, if you absorb here, it's zero because the electron goes somewhere else. And for the avalanche. And the total one is the gray, no? So essentially, you would like to get electron triggering the avalanche because you have a higher probability. And actually, this is, of course, there are more complex equations, but probably we are already going in a lot of detail for this purpose. But however, it's also easy to see, no? You can measure it. So we measure the detection efficiency. So you shine a light with a definite intensity, and you count how many times you get this signal from the photon on a diode which has a definite fill factor, with 100% fill factor, because we use a mask. So we select only the active region of the device anyway. And you measure, as a function of the bias, the photon detection efficiency. No? And you can see that it increases very fast for 400 nanometers, which is only electrons triggering the avalanche. Maybe I put the note here. Whereas it's a slower increase for 525, because actually it's a mixture of holes and electrons. Eventually, if you really use a very, very high bias, both electrons and holes have 100% avalanche triggering probability. But it takes you an unreasonable level of bias. So this is not useful. You typically operate it at 5 to 10 volt, or maybe 15. So this is why you use, for example, a p-n-n junction to detect the blue light, which is a typical application for the dark side, for medical imaging, for the readout of the scintillator, and so on. And finally, the filling factor. This is a microphotograph of the signal. You can see different microcells. There is a quenching resistor, the metal lines, and essentially the active area is smaller than the total area of a microcell, because, as I said, you need to get this virtual guarding around, no? To prevent lateral breakdown. And of course, you would like to maximize this, no? Because if it's very small, your detection is not very efficient. And this is a plot of the fit factor as a function of the cell size for different technology nodes, if you allow me the term, no? This is the old technology. We had a very large gap border. New technology have a smaller border, so you get almost the same fit factor that you have with the NUV with the 40 micrometer cell. Now you get it with the 20 micrometer cell, which is obviously good because you get either higher detection efficiency at the same cell or the same detection efficiency with many more cells. No? So you can choose essentially. No? Some application you want to get the maximum detection efficiency, you can allow to have a limited number of microcell per CPM. But there are some other applications that you that require a very high cell density. Why is that? Because, for example, as I said, you have this, it's not really a proportional detector. No? You have a saturation, an exponential saturation, logarithmic compression. So in some application, you can value, even if you lose a little bit of fit factor and thus of detection efficiency, you can value the fact that you have more spots, so you can, you are more resistant to saturation. And so this is the typical sensitivity spectrum that you have for any VHD 35 micrometer cell pitch as a function of the wavelength for different excess biases. No? As I said, you get a very good value, which is summing everything, no? The quantum efficiency, the fit factor, and then the avalanche triggering probability. You can see that essentially you reduce the PDA because the PDA thickness, the epitaxial thickness is limited. This is essentially driven by the electron avalanche triggering probability. Now you see that essentially it saturates to the maximum very quickly or relatively quickly at 10 volts. And this is the curves are more distant. Now for the same increment of excess bias or over voltage, you get a different. So this is, has yet to saturate essentially. And the other. Face of the coin essentially is the noise. Now, is an NME detector, I would say you have a signal, but you also need to know the noise because that's what ultimately sets your detection limit for a photon, for whatever you want to do, for the timing, for example. So, what are the noise sources in silicon photon multiplier? This is again a cross section, in this case, another one. No? In this case, we have a channel stop, we don't have the DTI, the deep trench isolation. That's fine. You have the shallow implant, you have the enrichment implant, and the high field region is here. Park, epitaxial. The first noise source is the primary thermally generated dark count rate, no? That follows the SRA statistic, short gradient hole, actually not really, but. And on the right plot, I put a persistence plot from the oscilloscope, no? So you have somehow the intensity equals the probability of getting something. And of course, this is the primary source of noise, the thick line here, no? With this fast peak, the recharge, and so on. But then what can happen is that because you have 1 million, 10 million of carriers passing through the high field region, you can have a certain cross-section of trapping in some deep states, the carriers. Now, maybe it's small, but you have a lot of trials. I have 1 million. Carriers 10 million. So some of them can be trapped and then released at a later time. We are talking about tens of or hundreds of nanoseconds here. And this is what we call after pulsing. No? And this is correlated noise. It doesn't exist if you don't have a signal or if you don't have a primary dark noise event. Okay. But it is important because, for example, it is related to the excess noise of the detector. It determines actually the excess noise factor. And the second thing that is very interesting, the avalanche itself, you have a lot of hot electrons, no? Which have energy, and they go in the conduction band. So there are many mechanisms by which, this is still a matter of research, but there are different mechanisms that can justify the fact that we know that the avalanche itself, it emits photons. And you are in the center of a single photon detector. So with a certain probability, which is small, you have three photons emitted in the near infrared, probably per million of gain of the avalanche. But this can also be a sword. And so if they get here to the substrate, this is a neutral region. So they are collected by not by drift, because there is no field, but by diffusion. And then you can have what is called diffused after passing. But if these photons are absorbed in a neighboring cell, you have this double amplitude event, no? Which is the crossover, direct or delayed if it involves transport by diffusion first. And of course, the crossover can be 1, 2. And the probability, because this is all related to the number of carriers passing through the high field region, is proportional to the gain, to the number of these carriers per avalanche. And how do you measure that? This is a typical waveform. This was acquired, I think, in the context of dark side. Essentially, you have these pulses and the baseline. You identify the peak, the amplitude, and the inter-arrival time. No? And from these pieces of information, actually, this is, we don't need this. This is when you have a very sparse event and you use memory segmentation in the oscilloscope. But essentially, eventually, what you can do, you build a scatter plot of amplitude that we of the peaks versus inter-arrival time. And you can see different features. And you can do also the projection along the x-axis and the y-axis. And you can see that this measurement technique has a sensitivity of 12 order of magnitude. So this is quite a powerful technique. And the main blob here is the dark, is the Poissonian distributed dark untreated. Believe me, this is in this peculiar scale, which is a semi-log Billing, Binning on the X. This is a Poissonian. And this is the main, you know, in amplitude. But then you have the direct crosstalk, so two cells firing at the same time. It must be a crosstalk. It's very unlikely that you have the generation of two events at the very same time. And then three, four crosstalk, and so on. This is the delayed, which is characterized by the diffusion time constant in the bulk, the lifetime, 20 nanoseconds. And then after passing, and this is in the same cell. So this is a smaller amplitude, but this is an exponential in logarithmic scale. This is the recharge of the microcell. Now, if the after passing happens while the microcell that originated it is still being recharged exponentially, you have a lower amplitude. Now, you retrigger, but it didn't reach the full overvoltage. It's a smaller amplitude. And so this is a, okay, this is a very clear separation. There are more complicated cases. This is a very clear separation because this is cryogenic measurement. No? The dark rate is around 1 hertz per square millimeter, which is very, very far from what you get at room temperature, and we'll see later on. And which are the sources of primary dark count rate? And this is the plot I showed you previously. So in the high field region, you have SRA statistic, but actually Paul Frankel and Trapp-assisted tunneling. So Friedenhass generation. And this is the dominant source of noise at room temperature. You have SRA statistic in the drift region because you do generation, but you don't have a high field compared to this. And then you might get diffusion from the neutral or quasi-neutral region at the edges of the junction. And they all have different temperature dependence, so you can study this. And finally, as regards the noise sources, I would suggest, at least as a FK, we suggest, this is just a comparison, no? This is the direct crosstalk. It's one of the enemies, most important problems in the detectors, no? Non-idealities. So you want to plot it as a function, for example, of the bias that you apply, no? Which is also determining the photon detection efficiency. And you see, this is for different cell sizes. You see, okay, the big cell size, it's reasonable, no? You have much more gain because it's proportional to the area. You have much more crosstalk probability. However, you are not taking into account that this cell has also probably a much higher detection probability. And so in your application, the question is, does this really matter? Or maybe would you use this plot in which you plot the nuisance parameters, such as the direct crosstalk, as a function of the signal or the sensitivity at the wavelength of your interest. And in this case, you can see you might even draw a slightly different conclusion, no? That maybe they are not that different after all. So this is maybe, at least in this plot, is maybe more like a feature of the technology rather than on the cell size, no? Depends on the trench isolation, for example. And the final parameter I want to, this was a quick overview in some sense of all the relevant parameters. And I think you are understanding, it's quite a complicated device, no? That's why we need to do studies on this, no? It's not like just apply the bias, works. There are many aspects that require attention. The final parameter, which is very relevant for the application, not so much maybe for the cryogenic applications, but you never know, because of course, is the time resolution. As I mentioned, actually, it's one of the strong points why the SIPM is used in the medical, for example, or in the LIDAR, or in the high energy physics. And this is the single photon time resolution spectrum, no? Again, you shine a laser. I don't know if I put the animation, no? It is absorbed here, and then you trigger an avalanche, you put a threshold, and this is the time delay spectrum, no? So sometimes you detect very early, sometimes very late. And this is 5 nanoseconds, by the way, no? So very late, of course, depends on the scale. But anyway, you can identify at first order two things. So the first one is the main SPTR peak. It has a quasi-Gaussian distribution. And basically, it's when you generate in the depleted epitaxial layer. So you have a drift field. So the charge collection is fast. And then why is not, isn't it a line? Because as always, you have noise, non-ideality. And in this case, you might have charge collection jitter, transit time spread. But most of the time, it's just electronic noise in the readout, no? But then if you absorb in the neutral or quasi-neutral region, you have a diffusion tail, which has a very definite, or maybe more than one, but typically one exponential tail. And this is important to know, and for some application is crucial, for some other a bit less, no? Because of course you see there are orders of magnitude, but if you really want to look here, you want to detect for some physics that you want to observe, you really want to have a clean spectrum of time delay. Typical case is the fluorescence lifetime microscopy. You want to understand how much the relaxation time constant of the fluorescein is changed because of the level of the pH in the local solution. And then it changes a little bit. And so you don't want to have problems here. And this was a single spud. What happens when you go from a single spud to a silicon photomultiplier? There are a couple of things more to take into account. Essentially, the signal changes because the SIPM, no, single cell, 1 by 1, 3 by 3 millimeter, the SIPM gets bigger in size. You have a bigger output capacitance. The signal is slower. It gets filtered. And so the slope gets also slower, and for the same level of noise, baseline noise, you have a jitter, an amplitude variation. And so this is one of the most important things. The second most important thing is that you have a transport within an area, no? So the signal generated by a microcell here should reach the bond wire, no? This is not the speed of light, it's not a transport, or it's more like a self-filtering effect, no? It is a change of the shape of the signal as a function of where you generate it, whether it's far or close or far from the readout. And you can measure this. This is not a variance, it's a skew. And you can see that if you use a single wire bonding, you can have a very clear trend, no? And this is 100 picosecond. But if you add a second wire bond wire here, you get a much better variation. And if you add three, of course, the scale is different. You even reduce that. And that's why you have a very thick bus at the bottom, for example, not compared to the thin one, which would compromise the signal further. And I think this is it as regards the introduction. And maybe we can get some questions if you have.
I have a question about the dark objects. Is it like any relation with the high radiation environment, for example?
No, absolutely. This is a topic of research, and I have a few slides in the next presentation. assuming I will have time to show them all. No, I just wanted to give you an overview, no? So maybe someone sees something interesting. The slides are shared and you can always contact me in case, you know? But probably I will have time to just discuss a little bit. Of course, you have damage, you have bike damage, and you get a much worse dark raid, which is a relevant, probably the most relevant topic for the high energy physic, for using the XIPM in high energy physics or in space.
Other questions on this introduction?
Okay, so maybe, yeah, probably it's also time to ask, because typically in this school you said that there are some engineers and the more...
A few, okay.
Should we embarrass them?
Ask them.
Yeah, who is the... Okay. Okay. No, because of course, this is a topic which is the boundary, no? Level, and maybe in the next presentation you will see. So it's quite common, no? But in my group, as a matter of fact, we have half and half. Actually, majority is physicists, because of course it's a bit outside of the comfort zone of people who are studying physics. But at the same time, we encounter, and maybe you can confirm, or a lot of physicists who are actually doing electronics to build an experiment, because experiment should eventually work. And maybe I will show you the research which is being done also in the field of detector. So it's a board, but of course it's also very linked to the electronics, the solid state physics.
But this is exactly the purpose of this lecture here today. I mean, we started from phenomenology. One of the lecturers was the theorist, for instance, but then we delved into detectors and now some specific application today, radioactivity screening and detection. So we want to cover, and somebody is more comfortable in one aspect and others in others, but that's why we're here. It's a school.
Okay, so as I said, I introduced the most important parameters for a silicon photomultiplier, so maybe we can now understand a little bit better what we are doing at PK and with partners, and one of the most relevant partner is IMFEN, obviously, to improve the performance of these devices in a specific application, and we have many, no? And many different partners for those. I will start from the timing in positron emission tomography. This is not big physics experiment, but as a matter of fact, this is the physics community, part of them, they are really working in medical imaging. And for example, at CERN, there is the group of Etienette, or Paul Geoffrey, Paul Lecoq, who did the crystal clear collaboration and many other activities which are relevant for both the experiments, but also for the medical imaging. As a matter of fact, now Paul Lecoq, for example, is working in a spin-off company for improving the performance in the medical imaging. As I said, where do we start from? So we start from the NUHD, which I have already shown, and this is already state-of-the-art technology for this application. No? And I remind you that in the PET application, the figure of merit, which is relevant, is the time resolution in detecting the time of arrival of the gamma, 511 gamma, inside the scintillator, which is normally NYSO, lutetium orthosilicate, is a little crystal, high density, obviously, to stop the photons. And so what we get here is, so there is a strong dependence, as I said, of course, on the detector parameters. You need to have high detection efficiency, but also on the readout electronics, no? And the plot here in the center compares the single photon time resolution with the two different readout, no? As a function of the leading edge triggering threshold, no? Where you put the trigger compared to the height of the signal. And if you use a high frequency amplifier, which is a new one described by Stefan Gundacker, who also was working at CERN, indeed, it's a collaboration between Spicock and Stanford, you get an important improvement. So you get 90 picosecond single photon time resolution, to be at maximum, with a 4x4 square millimeter device. If you remember what I showed before, we got 180 on a 3x3. So So this is an important improvement, and thanks combined to the high detection efficiency, because you really want to detect all the photons from the scintillator, we got this paper, which is the world record in timeless solution for the PET. No? So a small crystal, you get 60 picoseconds, well, actually 58 picoseconds to reach the maximum, whereas with the clinically relevant scintillator, which is 20 millimeter, 2 centimeter, which is enough to stop the 511 kiloelectronvolt, you get less than 100 picosecond. So this is a state of the art. So what can we do next? Something you can do is measure the single photon time resolution with collimated laser light within a microcell. Now, so this is the SPTR versus position inside the microcell. And what you see is that at the edges you have a deterioration. So the very trivial solution could be I put a mask, a metal mask on top, and you do the experimental approach. So active area in red, masking in blue, no? And you try different overlaps between the active area and the masking. And so you should get rid of the worst part of the single photon time solution. And as a bonus, you increase the capacitive coupling between the resistance, so the quenching capacitor, essentially, no? The coupling between the readout and the, which is this one, and the active area, which is below. No? And also you get a very nice signal extraction. No? If you remember, the time skew was related to the lines, the combs of the metal lines. So this, you have a grid. Is it effective? Yes. This is the CTR improvement with the BGO crystal, which is a Cherenkov emitter as well. And by just this layout change, you improve from 360 picoseconds to 310. No? 50 picoseconds improvement just by changing the layout. Of course, this requires some studies before, no, to get the solution. But this is with the standard amplifier, which we design in Amplicane. With an upgraded amplifier, because as we said, the speed of the noise and the noise of the readout is very relevant in determining the time resolution, you get, with the so-called high-frequency readout, you get 122 picoseconds per liter al maximum in the coincident time resolution with the BGO, which was never reported before. And this is very relevant because it might enable building positron emission tomography machine with the BGO instead of the LYSO. And the LYSO is critical because its supply chain is from China and it's very expensive because it's in. And so this, there is some relevant interest, and the project was carried out with UC Davis. As I said, the effect on the area of the CPM area on the SPTR, I already showed you, no? 180 picosecond on a 3x3 square millimeter, where you start from 50 picosecond with a single cell. So what could you do? You could do segmentation of the active area. So this is a 3x3, yeah. So you have a strip like a CPM. So this could be a test vehicle to study how segmenting the CPM area in this case 10, so you reduce the output capacitance by a factor of 10, you can get a better timing resolution. How much better? I think this is a promising solution because on a few samples with the masking, we got a very interesting single photon timing resolution of 28 picosecond per liter al maximum. No? Yeah. Yes, power outage, but only partial.
So there.
Maybe it's already solved. No, mi rispettare.
Provo a parlare.
Ok. Ok, so maybe you can. Ah, ok.
LISO, LYSO. I think I shared again. Should be fine. The audio is fine. Okay, good. Okay, so we can move on here. So for timing performance, segmentation is a very promising thing. Then, okay, we should wait the pointer here. Okay. Another development, as I said, is so we have a problem of correlated noise. So the optical crosstalk is something which is we don't want. Why? The reason is that, as you can see here, this is the typical reverse ID of a silicon photomultiplier, no? And this is the overvoltage. You get the breakdown voltage here, no? Because this axis is subtracted, the breakdown voltage is subtracted, so the breakdown voltage is around 0 volt. Then you have the useful operating region, and then at some point you have a second divergence, if you want, which is essentially caused by the correlated noise. And how can we say that's correlated noise? We can have a first order model with a very simple approximation. So we can say that the excess charge factor, which is the excess of avalanches, if you want, or of charge, that are caused by the existence of the correlated noise, so in excess of the primary noise, can be modeled as a geometric series with the geometric series approximation. So, and we also said that the probability of correlated noise is at least proportional to the gain of the device and thus to the excess bias. So it means that for every technology, there must be a voltage, an overvoltage actually, for which the probability of correlated noise approaches one. And that's essentially an asymptote, no? And this is what's happening here. So when you reach or close to 100% probability or 80% probability of having crosstalk, the device is always triggering crosstalk, even if you have a single initial event. So you have a limit of the useful operating region of this IPM. And the second problem is that you also get a worse few photon time resolution, which is relevant, for example, for PET or whenever you need to trigger timing with more than one photon. You can see here there is a time delay spectrum of when you have a single detection of a single photon, two photon, and three photon. And as you expect, the Gaussian part of the SPTR spectrum gets better. Because essentially, if you detect two photons, the signal is twice as big and the electronic noise is the same, you get less variance. However, you also see that there is a delayed, you start observing a delayed peak, which is most likely linked to the optical crosstalk. And because in a real application, you can never discriminate, you know, whether you triggered on two photons for real or one photon plus a crosstalk, the net effect is that you worsen the time resolution. So you don't like the correlated noise. And things get even worse because in most of the application, you use the SIPM to read out something, obviously. And this something can be a scintillator, no? So the scintillator is carefully engineered to keep all the light inside. And this is also relevant for a time projection chamber, no? It's a very, very big chamber. In which there are many silicon photomultiplier facing each other, no? And essentially you keep the light from the scintillator inside, but you can also reflect back the crosstalk photon. So you increase the charge collection, the photon collection probability for the secondary photons of the optical crosstalk. So you essentially at the same bias increase the photon, the correlated noise probability. And in this case, it's very visible even from the IV. So this is two different temperature, again, the breakdown here. And then you have the second divergence that I just described. But when you put the scintillator on top, the second divergence is shifted back to a lower excess bias because you have a higher probability of getting the crosstalk for the same number of emitted photons. So the problem is even worse in a real application compared to what you see on a data sheet. How do we solve that? In this case, we did an R&D together with Broadcom, who funded the development. And essentially, this is the cross-section of a microcell, which is, as you remember, no, the high-field region, the deep trench isolation.
And normally the deep trench isolation is filled with oxide. The oxide is partially effective in isolating optically the microcell laterally. But in this development, we added metal filling, which is tungsten, inside the deep trench isolation. And the effect is that at the same excess bias, in black you see the crossover probability for the original technology, which is the NVHD, deep trench isolation with oxide filling, and for the NVHD metal entrenched technology, which is in red. So you get a tenfold reduction. You can see that obviously also in the reverse ID, no? The original technology is in the black, whereas the upgraded technology is in red. And sorry, the dashed line, we compare the two technology with the addition of the scintillator. So without the scintillator, you basically have zero crosstorque, because the crosstorque is only internal, no? You don't have anything on top of that. But even if you put the scintillator on top, you have a very significant improvement with the empty technology, because at least the internal crosstalk is quenched. And so you get a much higher usable range. The detection efficiency is as good as before, or at least a little bit better, because you can stretch a little bit more the bias. This is a sensitivity spectrum that tops at most at 70%. And as I said before, the noisiest parameters are better plotted as a function of the PD, in this case at 420 nanometer. And so you compare the noise of different cell sizes of DMT in red. So you get around 40 kilohertz per square millimeter. And the optical crosstalk probability in black, you have the NVHD technology, in red, the MT, and in blue, DMT, let's say with something on top, which is in this case is represented by a glass carrier wafer, which is used for the true silicon via, which I have not discussed yet. So a very important improvement. And of course, this is relevant for the applications, not so relevant if you use the standard amplifier, because essentially this was the coincidence rolling time in LISO with the original technology in black, and the new technology extends indeed a lot the operating range, so the divergence of the correlating noise. However, you were already in an almost flat region. But anyway, this is very relevant from an industrial and also from an experiment point of view, because here the optimum is just a single bias, like one voltage. You select it wrong, you get much worse. Whereas in a real system, you really want to operate in a plateau, and that's a very relevant difference. And of course, we also improved it with Aachen. In this case, with the high frequency readout, we improved by just a few picoseconds the previous world record. But this is how you sell devices to the big company, by the way. So, and the masking and the reduction of the correlating noise is even more important when you have a photon starved application, because the VGO is mainly a Cherenkov radiator, if you consider it for timing. So the fast photons are only Cherenkov, and you have very few of them. And so the SPTR and the reduction of the crosstalk is even more important, and you get 103 picosecond, while it used to be 122. And 200 picoseconds with the clinically relevant size, so 2 centimeter thickness, compared to the 240. So a constant improvement of the technology. Now, maybe this is what is more interesting for you, but again, I don't want to limit, also because somehow it's not the latest development, but I think this is probably informative and interesting for you. Our activity started actually before that side, but were really fueled by the dark side activity and collaboration, because that was a really strong motivation for us. And so that it's an enabling technology. So having a silicon photomultiplier that can effectively operate at cryogenic temperature is one, not the only one of the enabling technologies for the time projection chamber that are being realized right now. And what we had to do, the first development, the most important maybe, was that, well, does it work in cryogenic temperature? And this is not obvious. This is a plot of the dark noise as a function of the temperature for the standard field. So what was a standard technology for us at the time in 2016, I think. So what you see here is that you have exponential part, and then a saturation of the dark rate, which cannot go below a certain value, which is 1 hertz per square millimeter. And then we devised a variant, so this was R&D on the device itself, no? So we changed the shape of the electric field in the high field region to achieve what we call a low field. So you get the same triggering probability with a lower peak value of the electric field. And the difference is that thanks to this upgrade, you're able to reduce the dark rate from room temperature to the operating temperature in liquid argon, which is around, well, actually 87 Kelvin. We test in liquid nitrogen, which is 77. It's not very different, by 7 orders of magnitude. And you can identify different regions. In particular, you have the thermal generation, what I told you before, SRH, field enhanced generation, which is here, but it's not very obvious to have a difference between the two technologies in this case. Whereas you have, at some point, you reach another physical source for the thermal generation, or generation, which is band-to-band tunneling, which is dominant as soon as the thermal generation goes below. That's why I said the different physical phenomena for the noise generation in SIPM have different temperature dependence, and that's relevant for the application. So for that side, we had to focus on the reduction of the band-to-band tunneling, which is dominant in this region. It's maybe a little bit less relevant for xenon operation, no? Because that's 187. As a matter of fact, it's not true. Also here, you have a certain advantage when using the low field variant. But still, that was very important for dark side, because you got the 20-fold improvement. And it's also nice to see the same plot. This is the same plot, but as an Arrhenius plot, And you can see that in the thermal generation region, you have a certain shape of the dark rate, no? So essentially, you increase the dark rate when increasing the bias. So these plots are at different biases, 4, 5, 6 volts. With a certain shape, which is essentially saturating, no? That's the shape of the triggering probability. You have a certain generation rate, and you trigger it like if it was light. Whereas in tunneling regime, the generation is not constant. It's heavily dependent on the field, and thus it's also heavily dependent on the bias. And then you can see that even if the triggering probability doesn't change a lot, you change a lot the generation rate, and you see a very, very different shape of the dark rate as a function of the bias for two different temperatures, close to room temperature, close to liquid nitrogen temperature. And that was relevant and was also part of the debug activities that we had to do in Gran Sasso, because at some point we were measuring the low field at this temperature and we had a very high dark rate. And we didn't know whether the technology was effective or not. But what helped us in debugging the thing was that the shape of the noise that we were observing in liquid nitrogen was the same as or comparable to the room temperature shape. And it was not consistent with the tunneling generation. And so eventually we realized that at this level, so this is very low level, so it means, I have a slide later, but it means that at this temperature, you need to wait 3 days to observe a single dark count in a microcell. So it's a very sensitive condition. So even a very, very small light leak could completely mess up with your measurement. And this was the problem. So there was a very, very subtle light leak in the cryostat, and we thought it was not going well. Some people in the collaboration also said that the whole INL band and the FPK devices were not working. But as a matter of fact, it was a measurement artifact, and we both obviously were happy to find it out. Second problem to solve was the afterpassing, because again, as I said, afterpassing is delay, trapping and delayed release by trapping center in the device, in the silicon. However, at the cryogenic temperature, the release time constant of the traps, whatever they are, they become longer. And so there is an increasingly higher number of carriers that are released when the microcell is fully recharged, so they can be triggered. And of course, this is a matter of luck. This is the afterpassing probability, or bad luck in this case, it tops out at 70 Kelvin. No? So it was a problem, because again, you reduce a lot the dynamic range, the bias range that you can apply, the second divergence. And it had to be solved. And one of the solution was shifting again from the standard field configuration of the electric field, the low field configuration, so that essentially we observed a significant reduction of the after passing probability. And essentially this was the situation. Huh? At room temperature, you can reach 18 volt. At cryogenic, before finding all the solution, you got such a relevant decrease of the useful bias range that was essentially making it impossible to use the devices. So also this part, this plot is relevant for the cryogenic operation and the improvement of this plot. And finally, in this plot, I show, basically we tested more than one process split. This is part of the research that we are doing. And essentially what you get, room temperature is solid lines. So not much difference between the splits of the process as regards the second divergence of the noise. However, a very noticeable difference of the second divergence in 77 Kelvin. And finally, we also had to change a bit the quenching resistor to make it not to, to make it stable with temperature. So essentially, with the new recipe, you have this is the value of the quenching resistor near room temperature, this is the value of the quenching resistor at 70 Kelvin. There is only a 10-fold max variation, whereas it used to be more than 100. And that also created a problem in the operation of the device. So the combination of all these splits gives you what is called the NVHD Calvin technology, which has an increased operating range, a stability of the quenching resistor, and low dark generation. And this is the nice plot. Now, that shows that this is an enabling technology, because, of course, this is, if you want, marketing, no? Nobody would. But in the real application, dark side needs very large areas. So it's not only about having a good number, is that you really need to not be overwhelmed by false triggers. And in this case, the more relevant figure of merit is that a 10 by 10 square centimeter area in cryogenic temperature has a dark rate of less than 100 Hz, which is manageable by the device. And that's how we are now, well, together with mainly Gran Sasso is building the experiment with the FEK technology, which was transferred to a foundry for volume production, because it is a sizable volume. No? And also, you have a good, this is just an example of the result. No? This is our tile of a silicon photomultiplier, in this case fabricated still inside FMK, so before the technology transfer to a foundry. And essentially, you use a single channel to read it all, and you can separate very nicely all the photoelectrons. No? You detect one photon, two photon, three, four, five, and six. And there is a spin-off of this activity. Now we are involved with the Bologna and the Milano Bicocca mainly in the June experiment, in which in this case we do another production, the object is here, and the news for us is that we are now responsible for building the final object, like a commercial entity. So in this case we did the research, we did the technology transfer of the silicon, but we also had to build a package which is industrially relevant. So industrial level means that you need to provide warranty, that you need to provide tolerances that are very tight, because of course, once you install a device in a big experiment, it's like sending it to the space. You don't open it to replace something which is not fine. And so this is a new challenge, maybe a bit different, you know, from the typical detector development challenges, but still very relevant, because after all, it's 5 square meters, 140,000 channels, 300 wafers, and so on. And we are now executing with funding from INFN and from CMOT. And this is a slide about the foundry. Just to show, this is in Italy, so we are happy that we are collaborating with an Italian foundry. And this is capable of very large wafer volume, which is probably better in this case. We could handle the dark side production in-house probably, but this would completely book our clean room, so this is better also for us that it's carried out externally. When you have to do a lot of the same, it's no longer FPK probably, or not necessarily FPK, we are more for the research. Another spin-off activity is Nexo. In this case, we need the vacuum ultraviolet sensitivity for the direct detection of the scintillating light in xenon. And what we did, at least as a first order approximation, is the R&D just on the anti-reflective coatings. Essentially, we assume that the quantum efficiency, the collection efficiency inside the silicon part of the silicon photomultiplier is already good. So what we work is to remove the silicon nitride in the anti-reflective coating that is sitting on top of the silicon, because the nitride absorbs the light at 178. So we should remove. And thanks to this removal, you get a very nice sensitivity even at 175 nanometer. This is an independent measurement done at Stanford, but now we're getting organized with a cryostat and a new vacuum ultraviolet monochromator to characterize this also at FPK. And this is still open. We are competing with Hamamatsu, and we will be or we will not be selected for the next experiment. And as you probably know better than I know, they are really fighting with radio purity in this experiment. And one of the things why they appreciate a bit the collaboration with the FPK is that it's all custom. So we are very open to send the starting material, to send the wafers for them to test the different layers, the materials used for packaging, or maybe even the metal lines, or the backside insulation material if you have TSV. So this is a nice scientific collaboration, and I think they are progressing rapidly towards a decision. I think we are a bit late, so probably I will skip the detailed description of this, but everything in some sense is useful for different applications. So this development was for big science, but it is also useful for our pets, because there are scintillators such as barium fluoride that are very, very fast, and they are also useful for medical imaging. And this is basically a new world record for PET recently published. Answering the other question from before, a very relevant application of the silicon photomultiplier and the challenge is increasing the radiation hardness for the for the high energy physics, but also for space. And this is why we care about that. LACB, but not only, of course, there are three experiments. We are doing R&D for ALIS, for LACB at least, and we did something for CMS. And we are in the RD4, which is essentially about radiation hardness and timing for CERN. But first of all, we need to qualify. We need to be able to understand how hard are these devices. And because we are a foundry, essentially we can throw it into whatever we want. And we have many types of devices, and we can test them all for damage. We are now focusing on, this is just a report on a previous test beam, quite old right now, but it's very good to explain. And we were focusing here on non-ionizing energy loss, so essentially neutron damage, or the part of non-ionizing damage from protons, for example. And what you can see here is that, again, the usual ID, which you have learned by now, you have the breakdown, you have the pre-breakdown current, which is not useful for the application, but it's there anyway, in the post-breakdown. And you see a very steep increase, huh? Because there is bulk damage, and you increase a lot the thermal generation. This is all room temperature. But first of all, you need to be able to measure the different parameters. So even calculating the breakdown, so if I had to calculate the breakdown here, it's very simple, right? It's a step. However, when you get this situation, also that part, and I will not go into the details, there are papers, maybe some of them are cited, it is a challenge, because you want, for example, to understand whether or not the breakdown changes with the irradiation. And it seems that at least within this level of fluence, it does not change. And then the second thing is that you want to understand how much the dark rate, the generation rate, increases. And this is a bit of a challenge, because at this level you are you have such a high noise in the detector that you cannot apply the waveform, the pulse analysis that I showed you in the previous presentation, because you have an overlap, a full overlap of pulses at the point in which you are no longer precise. So what you can do is normalizing the current. And normalizing the current requires dividing it by the gain, because say the current is proportional to the dark rate times the electron charge, of course, times how many electrons flow in the device for each avalanche, which is the product of the gain and the excess charge factor, which is defined as I said before. And from this, you can get to that, which is the plot, in this case, a 3x volt of excess bias of the dark rate as a function of the fluence. And as you can see, there is a better slide here. You can zoom in the low fluence range, and then you have a lot of variation. But that variation is not because of the radiation. That's the original variation of the dark rate among different technologies. Please keep in mind that I'm comparing here very, very different SIPN technologies. Whereas in the second part, you have an uniformizing effect by the radiation. So essentially, you still have some changes, some variation between different technologies of the dark count rate. However, they are much more reduced compared to the initial part. So this says that yes, you can do something with technology optimization to get some more radiation hard devices, but not too much, at least not within the space of parameter that you explore. And the fact that it is exponential is expected, no? Because of course this is the sum of many small independent effects. So exponential fluence, exponential dark rate. Another thing which is very relevant, and it's not studied so much in MPK, but it should be cited here, we have partners, and the good ones are also in Bologna. No? For example, Preganella is doing a very nice job, and we are also working with Ljubljana, with ROC, Pestotnik, and other partners, is, for example, the effect of the annealing. So you have a time zero, and then you heat it up, or you just wait at different temperature, it depends. And you can heal part of this defect. But this should be better studied, especially as regards higher annealing temperature, because some people, including Roberto, have demonstrated that there are threshold temperature. So some defects cannot be cured independent on the duration of the annealing procedure, which is basically the time you heat up the device, unless you go beyond a certain temperature. There are a few references. Okay, I think this we can skip because it just says that the other parameters, they do not change a lot with the radiation. And maybe what is interesting is that we did another test beam in Catania, in this case, in which we were more interested in studying the effect of temperature on the dark rate after irradiation. And so what you do, this is IV versus temperature. You can see that there is an obvious shift of the breakdown, which is totally as expected. This is before irradiation. And you can also increase the dark rate and thus the current, this one I told you about, when you heat it up, because you have more thermal generation. This is a thermally activated process, if you remember, not the radius plot or the dark count rate plot. And you can do the plot, you can extract also the dark rate versus excess bias from the waveform analysis. You combine this data, and what you can see first, this is a plot of the dark rate as a function of the temperature at cryogenic temperatures and near room temperature. And the first observation is that you can extract the activation energy here, and the activation energy goes down with the fluence. So something is happening. So you may be creating more defects that are then field enhanced, or you may create a particularly nasty effects. But anyway, after irradiation, and you are considering a very high level of irradiation by SIPM standard, maybe not by tracker standard, you reduce by a lot. And this also means that cooling becomes less and less affecting in curing, on putting some remedy to this damage. Please keep in mind that many experiments, some experiments at least, are considering already cryogenic operation after irradiation. As far as I know, at least LACB is considering liquid nitrogen for the next upgrade, whereas some other at least cool down to minus 50, minus 70 degrees. And the second plot, which is interesting, is that the same data essentially as a function of the fluence for different temperature. And as you can see, before irradiation, because we learned that the low fluence basically you get the dark rate that you got before irradiation. Cooling, like a la dark side, is rather effective, as expected, in reducing the dark rate. And it still is effective up to 10 to the 11 or 10 to 12. But then something a bit dramatic happens. And this is just a single sample, so we need to understand. But essentially, this is a very interesting topic of research, also for the microphysics of the device. Because at this point, in this region, cooling is no longer effective in reducing the dark rate. So what can we do next? And I think, yes, we are in time. We can just show you the next trends. Okay, we can do some electric field engineering because that, as we said, can help a little bit reducing the dark rate after irradiation. So if you compare here, the better ones are the one with the lower field. I didn't go too much in the detail, but only marginally. What can do? What else can you do? One thing you can do is, for example, exploiting light concentration, which is actually being studied by us together with the EPFL for LCD sci-fi tracker. You put some micro lenses in this peculiar arrangement, which is typical, which was proposed by EPFL, so they really like this, in which essentially you increase the active area of this IPI, and you basically, if you remember, there are these dead areas around the pixels. And then you, according to this simulation, you can get rid of most of them by applying this checkerboard configuration of micro lenses, which is also represented here. So this is a broken device, which allows us to see the microcells and the micro lenses on top. But the same concept could be applied also to enhance radiation hardness if you do light collimation on top of each microcell. So basically you have the light sensitive region, which is the same, but the damage sensitive region in silicon, which is much smaller. So this is a potential application of the microlenses to enhance radiation hardness. This microlens material is not necessarily radiation hard though. So there are studies by CSCM, I think, together with ESA, selecting some materials that can be considered radiation hard. But another approach which we did together with MultiWave, this is a spin-off in which Paul Lecoq from CERN is working, and then Fresnel Institute, Bicocca and CERN, is using nanophotonics to do essentially a lens. In this case, a gradient index of refraction nano lens, in which it's quite easy after all. No? It's just a matter of patterning two materials with a different index of refraction. And so you basically are building a Fresnel lens. And so this can also concentrate the light to do that same effect as the micro lenses. And this is probably more CMOS compatible, apart from the strange material, which is niobium. But finally, the next generation of developments that you are doing at RPK is the 2.5 and 3D integration. This is depending on a big project we got, IPCI Microelectronics. It was a 2 billion euro project, not all of that for RPK. Fortunately, we got a very small slice of cake, because of course here there are big players, you know, like ST Microelectronics or whatever. You name it. Yeah. However, this was enough to build a new clean room dedicated to 3D processing. And 3D processing aims at upgrading the optical sensor technologies, which is essentially silicon photomultiplier, by adding through silicon vias, micro through silicon via, and backside illuminated technology. This is an example of the through silicon via that we are approach that we are following. This is called ViaMid Bark TSV. ViaMid means that it's done while you fabricate the microcells. So this is the usual microcells with the usual deep trench isolation that I told you before. And then we add some deeper trench isolation that are reaching the bulk. Then you do glass carrier wafer bonding. That's for mechanical support. Then you thin it down. So this cube of the bulk, and the bulk, if you remember, is high doping and low resistivity, gets isolated, and it is a conductor. So basically, you are bringing the signal from top to the bottom. And then you can do two things. If you thin it down not so much, the wafer holds itself together. And you can remove the glass carrier wafer, which is needed, which is mandatory for NEMS or for UV sensitivity, because this is borosilicate glass that kills, that cuts off the UV light. But you have a limit in the light that you can, in the density of the via, because this should be at least 100 micrometers, 150 micrometer thick. So the via should be in the same order of magnitude. Whereas if you leave it there, you can do ultra thinning to 10 micrometer and you have ultra small micro TSV. We are doing some tests. This is a nice cross section. Actually, the previous, this is not a scale. The real scale is this one. I have a very, very nice and small deep trench isolation. This is a microcell. And this is the huge via for the NEXO experiment, 150. And anyway, they are demonstrating a reasonable insulation. They are progressing. What do we do with this? This is more related to, again, medical imaging. So we go back because there is no separation. Even the partners in the PET Vision projects are the same. This is Lugano. This is Trigano. After, no? The guy is the same. So in this case, we are doing medical imaging project, and we do 2.5D integration, which is defined as when you basically have a device with true silicon via, passive interposer, and then the front end on the back side. So you are not doing the full 3D integration, but you still get a very fine segmentation, which is good for timing. If you remember what I was saying before, the SPTR is getting better if you get a smaller area of this IPM. And you also have a local readout, quasi-local, very, very close. So it's a good trade-off if you want to build a positive electron emission tomography module, which is high performance, but also cheap. And indeed, one of the goals of the PET Vision project is making the positive electron emission tomography accessible. Because at the moment, a PET exam is very high in cost. And so in the developing countries, it's a problem. And so we are trying to do our contribution, at least, maybe it will not be the end of the development, to make high performance PET. We already demonstrated SPTR 151 picosecond with this ASIC developed by CCUB in Barcelona, only 3 millivolt per channel. But at the same time, in some sense, without breaking the back, which is also relevant. We can skip this. A more recent approach, which I propose for the two silicon via, is the so-called glass, single cell access TSV, in which essentially still about TSV, but it's nicer in that you exploit the deep trench isolation, which is always present between ions and microcells, to build the via. So you thin it a bit more, and then you get that each cube is both the spud and its own via. And you can use that to connect every single spud to every single readout channel, which is not needed for every application, but it is quite advanced. And also, you keep in mind that the loss of fill factor for the via is almost zero in the single microcell. You have some bias in the world. And so we are doing some advanced segmentation concept. This is another project we have, Digilog with EPFL and Aachen. And in this case, we have to say it's not a single cell, but we are talking about a micro CPM. So it's a segmentation of 3x3 microcell, which is still in between, let's say, standard readout, 2.5, 1 millimeter pitch, maybe. This is 150 micrometer pitch. But of course, the end goal, which may or may not be useful for every application, because this is much more expensive, is the fully hybrid CPM. Which is essentially when you have one-to-one correspondence between the sensor wafer and the CMOS wafer, which also means that you need to pay for 20 square meters, it was dark side, of a sensor, and 20 square meters of maybe 28 nanometer CMOS, which is probably not the wisest solution. But it's actually very good for other applications. But first, if you want to do a paper, but also maybe if you have some application that require the ultimate timing performance on a smaller sensing area. So it's definitely very important. We are doing this in the context of the PNRR project Quantum in FBK. And that's it for the TSV. And finally, final topic, I have a couple of slides, I think we are totally within the time. Is the backside illuminated. This is relevant also because we have projects on that with IFN, that are with partners also sitting here. So no, but it's also because it's our really next generation of development, which is has pros and cons. Now, of course, if you need to build a working system for PET, you probably select something in which you have an incremental development because you want to get the system. Whereas in the long run, you have a longer development time for the backside illuminated. What is a backside illuminated? I think it's pretty self-explanatory. This is a sketch of a typical process flow for the near-infrared backside illuminated SIPM. Like before, you have the glass carrier wafer with temporary bonding, you do grinding from the backside, you do some processing, you basically polish, make a contact, and then you put a permanent wafer bonding at the backside, and then you debond the front side. But in this case, the difference is backside illuminated because the light enters from the bottom. And this is the simplest implementation because this is near infrared the light. And so if you remember, the absorption length is tens of microns at 905 nanometer. So you don't really care that much if something is left here. No, it can be maybe 5-10 micron. It's still working. So we did it, we demonstrated this, and essentially this is a picture of the first backside illuminated wafers demonstrated by FBK, one by 1 millimeter devices. This is almost transparent. And what you see here is the ID before and after thinning, and essentially they are working. And as a matter of fact, what you see here is an anticipation of the second divergence, but that's not because the device is broken. That's because you got a very different optical boundary condition. So basically you are reflecting back the crosstalk photon on the, from the backside surface, which used to be 500 micrometers far, but now it's 10 micrometers far away. And so it's expected. And anyway, we get very respectable numbers of photon detection efficiency of actually 20% in this plot, but even 30% on some speeds at 905 nanometer with a 15 micrometer cell. And I would say the final slide is what we are doing now. Actually, I should have added another logo here because we are really placing a lot of effort, putting a lot of effort, let's say, placing our bets on this technology, which will be supported by UC Davis, INFN with the IRIS project. So Alessandro Montanari is the reference person, but Gabriele, I think, knows something about that, maybe. And but we are trying to gather other groups from INFN to be working on that. And also we have recently acquired the European Space Agency project, and I will explain you in a second why. So the advantages. So this is really some more insight on the backside illuminating microcell structure. And that's to explain why it's a non-incremental development. So we did a very radical redesign of the microcell. So you have an almost uniform entrance window on the backside. The resistors and everything are on the top side. But on top of that, we have a charge focusing mechanism that collects, that brings all the charge that's photogenerated on the backside, because it is a backside illuminated, brings it to a much smaller avalanche multiplication region here. And thanks to the fact that it's smaller, you have a lot of space for the virtual gathering at the edges. If you remember, I discussed what is a virtual gathering. And this means that without, so you can make a very small cell with a very small high field region without having to compromise on the charge of the light sensitive region, which is a typical trade-off. If you remember when I was discussing the field factor versus the cell size, it was always a trade-off. You get a small cell, you have more density, less PD. Not here, because you have the charge focusing mechanism. So you can get up to 100% field factor, even with small cell pitch, which means that you can get 15 micrometer cell, ultimate interconnection density, assuming you want to do that because it's expensive. It's very high speed. It's 9 nanosecond, 5 nanosecond recharge. You have a uniform entrance window, which is actually very, very suitable for applying an enhanced optical stack. We are starting slow. We are doing plasma doping and laser annealing, which is a standardized solution for that. But you can imagine much more. There are people doing black silicon or the molecular beam epitaxy, boron, super lattice, and so on. And of course, the local electronics, as I already mentioned, is fine. There are challenges. This is definitely a low technology readiness level development. So you will definitely have charge collection time jitter to be verified, because the lines are not the same length. So you need, you want to verify that this G, I don't care about how much it takes, but it should be always the same. If it's not the same, you get a worse SPTR. Now, if you get 10 picosecond here and 50 picosecond from here, your SPTR is not going to be better than 50 picosecond or 30. So this is a challenge, but we have some technology solution. And then, as I said, the effectiveness of the Neumann transmitter is at research. And finally, what is really, or might be really interesting for radiation hardness, we already demonstrated or verified at least that the dark, the activation energy or the dark rate after irradiation goes down. And that's an indication that you have a lot of field enhanced generation. But where do you have field enhanced generation? Is where you have a field. In this case, the field region is much smaller compared to the collection region from the light. So you can expect a net advantage of radiation hardness by decoupling for the first time, at least for LBK, the region sensitive to radiation damage bulk, I'm talking about bulk damage, which is the high field region, from the region that's sensitive to light, which is you want to maximize. And I think this is all. And of course, this is all the team that I'm coordinating in FBK to this development. And as a matter of fact, we're also in dire need of new talents. So if you are interested, please drop me an email or check the FBK website.
So at which level? After PhD, what's the best situation?
There are two things. So typical configuration is we hire a researcher who can be before the PhD, but normally not during, no? Either you skip the PhD, there are some cases, or you do after the PhD. We're also having some PhD scholarships. I don't know how many master's students are here, so maybe this is pointless.
Just a few, but...
But we are also considering to have a PhD scholarship at the Polytechnic of Torino, which for which we don't have a candidate yet.
Okay, so with this, we thank you. Question.
Yeah, so you mentioned Nexo multiple times and that they want to use silicon photomultipliers. So all the dark matter xenon experiments use PMT, why they don't use them for radioactive? Security reasons,
yeah.
Are higher noise, right?
So I think probably I'm not the most adequate person to answer because that part is better handled by the experiment. However, of course, obviously we talk about this. I think, as far as I remember, for Nexo in particular, they care a lot about radio purity, which might not be optimal with the PMTs. There might be also some geometrical consideration because the PMTs are rather big. In this regards, the sensitivity in the vacuum, maybe you know more than I know, but I'm not sure because there is potential to further increase that 25%. So maybe you are at least on the same level or maybe the silicon could do somehow better. And as far as I remember, but from that side, so I'm not sure whether this applies also to Nexo, the noise at liquid nitrogen of course, you could say that the PNT is less noisy, and that's for sure true at room temperature. What happens at cryogenic is not obvious, because as you saw, you get a very, very strong reduction, 7 order of magnitude, so you really have 100 hertz on a 10 by 10 square centimeter. And as far as I remember from discussion with people from INFN, I guess that side, I don't know if it was Giuliano, you might get some problems in operation at cryogenic temperature in the tubes in case there is some maybe loss or leak of void in inside, and then they can be sensitive to training, is that the term? So it's not obvious to say that, especially at cryogenic temperature, the noise is potentially comparable or even better. It is, this is basically the feedback I got.
So I think the question, the answer is also, yeah.
Basically, silicon clearance at liquid xeno temperature is still great by our complex. That's the main reason. It's,
Well, it's better than the room temperature. It's, like we need to go way lower to like liquid argon temperature. So that's dark
yeah. Yeah, exactly. So there was a plot by Alberto showing that at the liquid argon temperature they are extremely good, but already at the liquid xenon, so 100 degrees above, that rate can be important. But the answer to your question is that in Exo, they care about the high energy Q value, okay? So 2.5 MeV. And we care about that rate because we want to go down in threshold and down to 3 photoelectrons. And if you have that rate, the accidental rate of 3 photoelectrons is huge. And this would spoil our threshold. But at 2.5 MeV, all same types, I'm joking. But it's a different regime, of course.
I have a curiosity about the afterpicing at the cryogenic temperature, because you saw that it increases at low temperature and suddenly it cools down.
We don't have we have a hypothesis for the moment. I guess at some point it might be possible that because this plot hides something, because as I showed, but I didn't have to go too much into the detail, there is also an increase of the charge time constant. And in this case, the charge time constant is written here, was or still before the upgrade we did. So it was very large at cryogenic temperature. So as a matter of fact, the increase of afterpassing in this case was a balance between the delay in the trapped charge release time and the suppression of the afterpassing induced by the increase of the recharge time constant of the cell. And so in this region, obviously the increase of the release time of the carriers trapped wins. So the net effect is you increase the afterpassing probability. But at this point, and actually we are preparing a paper on that because it's relevant for Nexo as well. No? You get more afterpassing than you would like, so we did further trials. At some point, probably you don't get an increase of afterpassing anymore, while you are still increasing the value of the quenching resistor, so you can go down. But in both cases, it's not acceptable, and that's why we need.
Other questions? Okay, if not, we thank so we are almost at the end. Now we have the final, a few final points.
Esatto, tu ti stacchi così rendo tutto. Devo rendere qualcosa. Questo è il fili, no?
Basta che tu stacchi e poi facciamo da
qui. Ok, questo. Questa era dentro qua. Serve? Qui era dentro qua. Non so se la volevi.
Proviamo. Sì, la cancia.
Guarda qui.
Qua. So before going to the final points, the awards and the parents. Few info. Knut, Nick Mora already put all the exercises in the consign, so you have all the solutions also of last session of yesterday. The videos, the movies, the recording of the lectures are on the YouTube sub channel, almost all of them. So the one of yesterday and today, of course. To be posted, and we will upload the third. This is, of course, not official, but I checked the train situation, and there are trains running from Torino to Bologna and elsewhere. So it's not the strike, it seems that the strike doesn't heat so much. So hopefully.
Are not going to have bus.
Say it again.
Are you going to have bus?
So the bus, the shuttle is confirmed. To Bologna. Yes, but since some people coming from Bologna have to go as well by train, they want to leave Bologna. Okay, so I will leave to Gabriele and Pietro later, a few minutes. Gabriele and Pietro for the poster awards.
Okay, so we have this big ceremony for the best posters awards. So actually, you voted, you all vote, almost all of you voted three posters. So we will give some prize to the three best posters. And so I think we can already see the third. So we will go through from the third one to the first. So the third place we have Emanuele Angelini. I think we have the prizes. Maybe we can take the. But maybe we can take the prizes and Gabriele. Okay, maybe so the winners can come here. So we have a small prize for the three. You also have to give a speech.
Again, another speech. No.
Okay, so let's go through the winners and then we will have the prizes given to the winners. So the second one is Giovanna Salet. And the winner is Sophie. Okay, now Gabriele will hand over.
Emanuele,
thank you very much.
Anna, thank you.
I think that was an error. I don't know.
Thank everybody.
Thank you. Honestly, I did not see myself in the top 10 even. I think there are so many really great posters. I don't know. I don't believe that there was something. I don't know. There was something wrong in the vote or something. I don't know. It's okay to come to bed later.
It's experimental physics, so the data told us that this is the
situation.
And there were 55 people voting, so I think that the statistics is representative.
Can we have? Shall we have a picture? Do you mind?
We go there.
Yeah.
Pietro. Can we have a picture here?
We can associate
the person with the
theory. I should do as a boomer.
Go in the boomer way.
Okay, I did some. Okay.
So we thank the winner again. And the...
I think you can go. So,
okay, we already covered the program, and after the school, in a few days, you will receive a form for a feedback. Okay, so there will be various questions. Among those, there will be also the contest for the best lecturer. So, in the first edition, which was online, Nicolao Fornengo won for the phenomenology on dark matter. At LNGS in 2022, Francesco Vissani for neutrino phenomenology. So phenomenology was, we'll see this time who will be the winner. I hope, no, I don't hope, but yeah. Okay, so it's time to go to thank the values people important for the school. So first of all, I would like to thank to really thank all the lecturers. So I think we can. Today we have Monica and Alberto here, many others. Where in the previous days, I think I can say that all of them were real experts. And recognize the expert in their field. So the panorama was extremely good, and I personally enjoyed the lectures very much. So really, thank you. Then I would like to thank the CEUB secretaries and all the staff. So here, Roberta and Giuseppe, but for everybody. So thank you. It was the first time that we had the school here, and we really found a beautiful, helpful, and smart environment to run the school and to spend a few days. Then the local organizing committee, so in particular Pietro and Gabriele, that together with me, so please come. And, you did a great job, not just during the days, but also in the previous preparation. And you may have recognized the various skills, the video, the posters, and all the, I have to say that all the, how do we call it, the merchandising was done by Pietro. Pietro is the guy of the colors. All the colors comes from him. And then last, so for the school, there are many ingredients, and one may think that what's important is the organization, the situation, the lectures, and so on. But in any school, from Hogwarts to the primary school of my kids, the real important person are you, so the students. And really, I'm not joking, but we would like to thank you for the official part, meaning your self-presentation, the poster session where you presented yourself, the activities and so on, but also for the informal part, which is relevant, important and crucial. So for the friendly approach, the lively environment, the discussion, the coffee breaks, the social dinner and so on, the way of living these days. So we appreciated it very much. I think we are going to miss you. And so thanks a lot for being here at the school.
Before going to lunch, we would like to have a last picture here. If you can come here, and then we keep the background of the logo of the school, and the picture will be taken by Roberta climbing.
Vediamo questo.